Welcome to Google Developers Live. My name is Peng, Ying, and with me today is my colleague, Nagesh.
Hey.
We're here today to share with you what we built for Google I/O. Both of us are engineers at Google, and what we like to do is solve problems. So today, let's first start off with the problem that we've found. Some of you may already be familiar with this, and don't get me wrong, I love Costco. Their pizza's awesome. I love their $1.50 hot dog and drink. And I was just there this past week and probably bought enough paper towels and toilet paper to last a year. But every time I go to checkout, it seems like utter chaos. There's carts moving from left to right, from right to left. Everybody's pretty much trying to find the shortest line. And that was the problem that we were trying to solve, checkout. We think that checkout is cumbersome and a little bit inefficient. So what's our solution? Well, it's what we're calling Web and Mortar. And today, we're here to talk about how it works, how we built each of the pieces, the Android app, the interactive wall, the backend, and some of fulfillment. And then we'll shed some light on where we hope this goes and what we hope to see a little bit further down the road. So what is Web and Mortar? It's an idea built from the Tesco wall. Web and Mortar is this concept of tying the online and offline shopping experiences together. You know, the most amazing thing about this image isn't that people are buying groceries in the subway station in Seoul, but it's that they have the cell signal to do so. I'm looking at you, San Fran. Nagesh, can you show them what we built?
Sure. It's nighttime and my favorite store is closed, but luckily the Web and Mortar store is here with an online catalog of the various products they offer. And here I have the top carousel and the bottom carousel, which can be scrolled. And when you select a particular item, it shows the 3D view for that particular item. In this case, it's a leather folder. Now, when I want to buy it, I bring up the Android companion app and I select the particular color that I want. So in this case, there were multiple colors. So each of them was listed in a special QR code. Let's add a few more items. Now, this looks interesting. Now, how about the squishy? I always wanted the chrome plushie, actually. Looks colorful. And I can even scroll it 3D here if I wanted to. Want to add it into my cart? Scan the QR code. There it is. Buy with Google. Choose a credit card. Goes to the next. And I submit the order, and I'm done with the purchase. Now that we've looked at the entire flow, let's look at how it works. Now for the buy flow, we used Google Wallet Instant Buy API. Now the beauty of the API is it is seamless in the sense that it does not require you to change your backend. If you already have an existing payment provider, you do not have to change it to integrate Google Wallet Instant Buy. What that means is if you accept credit cards, you can take a credit card from Google Wallet Instant Buy and pass it through your backend without making any modifications. Now, the other aspect which is very important is you do not have to do the credit card entry and management, like expiration dates, credit cards have expiration dates, and various other types which you do not have to deal with. You can let Instant Buy take care of that. Now, the other more interesting aspect is that Google Wallet Instant Buy returns a one-time virtual proxy card. So it's not the user's actual card, but it's actually a one-time use card, which is a credit card which can flow through your...
That's more secure, too.
It's more secure, too, exactly. So with that, let's see how the code looks like if I wanted to make a purchase. First, I would get my estimated price for a particular item. Call the masked wallet request.newBuilder, set the currency code, which is USD here, and call this load masked wallet method on the wallet client. Now the wallet client, now this is giving me a callback. Now wallet client actually calls Google Play services, which is installed on your Android device, and then gives me a callback on masked wallet loaded, which gives me the masked information, like the various credit cards that a user has. The selected credit card that a user has. So it shows up a screen to the user where he or she selects the particular card that they want to use. That is selected, and I get back that detailed information. I can get the shipping address if I wanted. I can get the phone number if I wanted to. And then, based on this information, I can calculate the next steps. Now, next steps, obviously, if I'm shipping, I need the shipping calculator. So I would send this zip code to the shipping calculator and get back a price. Let's say it's within the US, so it's $5.50 or whatever. Now, with that information, I ask the user to confirm the purchase or to review the order and actually press on confirm. Once they confirm, I can make a full wallet request. The full wallet request returns me a one-time use proxy card. Now, that's the card I can take and then pass to my backend, which then puts it through the payment processor, gets back a result like success or failure or whatever, and then puts it through my order system. Now, at the end of this, my server can then return a signal saying it was successful and this is the order number. I then call Google Wallet client and say that the transaction was successful, and then also notify the user that their order is being delivered. So that's how the Instant Buy was integrated into the API. Now, with that, let's look at how the other parts of the app were built. Now, the shopping cart is one of the most interesting aspects in the entire app. And to build it, there were several small things that were needed, obviously. The first one was to fetch an item field. Now, here, since the number of items that were there in the catalog were very limited, we fetched the entire catalog from the server using an intent service. Then this was stored in a SQLite database, and a content provider was provided to make it clean to access these items, as you would. Now, the scanning of the items was done using Zebra Crossing, which is an open source library which you can download and use. It's a very awesome library for QR codes and barcodes.
Any sort of codes.
Yeah, any sort of codes. It's a pretty awesome library. Now, once you have stored the, scanned the item, you can take it and store it in the shared preferences. Now, last but not the least was the swipe to dismiss item. If you wanted to take off items from your shopping cart, I really liked the gesture way of removing it, swipe to dismiss. And all that I had to do, thanks to my colleague Roman Nurek, was to just add two lines into my application to get this all done. And I mean, in addition to this, all I had to do was add a few more lines for an inner class. And I got all of it working like within 10-15 minutes.
Seems pretty simple.
Yeah. So it was very easy to integrate. Now, with that said, let's move on to the interactive display.
Thanks, Nagesh. So we created the interactive display using a few components. The UI is comprised of two carousels, a top carousel and a bottom carousel. They contain the same amount of items, actually the same items. And in the middle, there's a detail section. So the reason that we went with two carousels is because we thought that we wanted multiple people to interact with the display at once. I mean, one thing would be if you had one person interacting, then only one person could be purchasing. So why not just double that? The other thing is, it's kind of interesting to see what happens when two people are trying to interact at the same time and there's only one details page. Maybe it could lead to some sort of conversation. Maybe they could be like, oh, cool, I have that. You should get it too, or some sort of something like that.
Yeah.
To create these sections, what we use was, well, the whole thing is a web page. This entire thing is a web page. And what we're doing is we're using Chrome kiosk mode. And what Chrome kiosk mode is exactly what it sounds like. It makes a web page into a kiosk. So it removes the action bars, removes the search bars, removes all that kind of stuff. And you just get a minimalized UI that shows a web page. In addition to that, we did some other tricks to get rid of the mouse cursor by replacing the cursor with a transparent PNG. And then what we also did was we disabled right click. It's because you don't want somebody, so with a lot of touchscreens, if you do a long press, it actually acts as a right click. And you don't want anybody long pressing and then inspecting an element or doing some taking some sort of action on the page that you don't want them to take. Lastly, for all of the really nice physics-based scrolling, inertial-based scrolling, we used the Financial Times scroller. It's an open source library, and it handles touch events really well. What we're showing right here is a simple way to instantiate it. Basically, what you do is you define all of the elements that you want to scroll between, and then you instantiate the Financial Times scroller, passing in the DOM node and a few other parameters to define, hey, which way am I scrolling? What's the size? Do I want it to snap? That kind of stuff. Once we have the interactive display, we kind of need to feed it and populate it with elements. And what we're using is the same JSON that the Android app is using. The way that we formatted it is we have items, which are kind of actually the options of items. And we have an item map, which is the parent item. So in this example, let's say the t-shirt would be the item map. And then each of the different options, like, hey, I want this t-shirt in small, medium, or large, are the items themselves. And to pass all of this information, it's in JSON. So we're using one big JSON object that contains all of the items and all of the item maps. So once we have a display, people can browse through it. They can choose the items that they're interested in and then purchase it with their phone. We need to be able to send this information back to our server. So once the person has confirmed that purchase, what's happening is that this JSON that you see here is encrypted over SSL or whatever you choose, and then sent to the server. Within this JSON, we're defining things like the items that a customer is purchasing, their shipping address, their billing address, and their credit card information. Mm-hmm. Then on our backend, we can take this information, create a new order, maybe create a new customer, and then charge your order and maybe send it off to fulfillment. So that's how this all works. But it's cool, but it's just one of the possibilities that you can do with a really simple mobile purchasing API. And there's a few more that we thought of. What if you can make advertising actionable? Let's say that I walk by this poster for Elysium, right? That movie's coming out this weekend. Mm-hmm. I have my phone, and it's a smartphone, knows where I am, all that kind of stuff. I tap my phone to the poster, and it shows me a listing of showtimes that are around me and the theaters. And within a few clicks, I can buy that ticket, I can save it to my wallet, and then when I go to the theater later that day or sometime, instead of going to the purchase kiosk or going to any the box office or anything like that, I just walk in, pull out my phone, show them the ticket, and then walk to my theater, right? That's a way better experience. What about never having to go to the checkout line again? So today, what we showed you was somebody browsing this interactive display. What if you just got rid of the interactive display? What if the store was a display, right? So all the items within the store have their own barcodes. So what if you could just take your app, scan all the barcodes as you add the item to your cart, and then click checkout and walk out of the store, right? Like, that's way better than whatever clunky self-checkout experience exists now, where you take the item and then you scan it, maybe it doesn't scan, and then maybe you put it into the packing area, and then it says, oh, there's some other items in the packing area that aren't supposed to be there and all that kind of stuff. We can make that experience better. Lastly, what if, instead of right now, consumers come to the store, right? But what if you could take the store to the consumer? The old adage is what? Location, location, location. What if you could combine Instant Buy with same day delivery, and then you just bring this interactive display that has all of your items that is stylized to your store, pretty much your store experience, and you put it wherever the people are. Like, maybe it's a park, maybe it's a subway, maybe it's a bus, bus stop, right? And there you have it. You've taken your shopping experience, you have minimal footage, you have minimal costs, and then you deliver via same day delivery or some other sort of delivery service. Right. And our goal of this presentation has been really to give you ideas and to inspire you to think about what you can create. What are the problems that you can solve? What are the flows that you can streamline and simplify? And what you can do. We are here to help you develop amazing things. And with that, if you want to get started with Instant Buy, go to getinstantbuy.com. www.withgoogle.com. And lastly, follow us on G+. So we're always doing crazy stuff like this. We're working on samples. We're messing around with things. We're trying to be on the bleeding edge. So follow us on Google+ to see what we're doing. And thanks for coming and watching this with us today.
Thank you.